Now, I've titled today's message, You Can Take It to the Bank. When someone makes that statement, you can take it to the bank, that usually means it's an absolute certainty. Now, we've been told in life that there are only two certainties, and those certainties are what? Death and taxes. In other words, if the Grim Reaper doesn't get us, the IRS will. Amen? You know, when someone makes that statement, you can take it to the bank, that statement is only as good as the person making that statement. But when God says you can take it to the bank, you know what? That's an absolute certainty. Remember what I said, that statement is only as good as the person making it. And if there's one person in this life that you can trust, it's God. Amen?
Amen.
This morning I want to talk about three promises that God makes concerning prayer. And these three promises you can take to the bank. These promises are not made by some slick politician. They're not made by some slick con artist. They're not even made by your Uncle Joe, who has good intentions but has no means to fulfill his promises. No, these promises are made by the most powerful person in the universe. They are made by the most honest person in the universe. And so when God makes a promise, you know what? You can take it to the bank. This morning I want us all to turn to 2 Samuel, and we'll be looking in chapter 22, verses 1 through 7. Can I get everyone to please stand for the reading of God's Word? We have a few visitors. Can somebody remind me why we stand for the reading of God's Word?
Respect.
Out of respect. 2 Samuel 22, verses 1 through 7, beginning in verse 1. And David spoke the words of this song to the Lord in the day that the Lord delivered him from the hand of all his enemies and from the hand of Saul. He said, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold and my refuge, my Savior. You save me from violence. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. For the waves of death encompassed me. The torrents of destruction overwhelmed me. The cords of Sheol surrounded me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called upon the Lord. Yes, I cried to my God, and from his temple he heard my voice, and my cry for help came into his ear." Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you. We thank you, Father, that when we are in distress, when we are in trouble, when everything else seems to be going wrong, Lord, that we can call upon you, Lord. And when we call upon you, Lord, we know that you answer, Lord. We know that you are a person who keeps his word, Lord. Father, I pray today that you would just help us to see that every promise is a certainty, Lord. Every promise you make, Lord, they're also contingent, but they are certain. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning I want to talk about three promises, like I said, that God makes. And these promises you can take to the bank. The first promise that you can take to the bank is the promise of salvation. God says, when you ask for salvation, that's exactly what I'll give you. When you ask for salvation, that's exactly what you will get. Notice some verses that tell us this. In Acts 2:21, it says, "And it shall be that everyone," notice that word everyone, "and it shall be that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." And Paul repeats this idea once again in Romans 10:13. He says, whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. See, it doesn't matter how dark your past is. It doesn't matter how deep your despair is. It doesn't matter where you've been. Once those words leave your mouth, you know where they go? They go straight to heaven. I want to say this as well. God's not setting up in heaven saying, you know, I wonder if I should say so-and-so. I wonder if I should do that. You know, I heard him take my name in vain last week, and I've kind of been watching, and you know, he really hasn't been that nice to his wife this week, and again, last year I caught him cheating on his taxes, and all that wasn't bad enough. He's got this terrible drinking problem. You know, I just don't know. Should I or shouldn't I? You know, God doesn't do that. You see, when God decided to send his son to come to this earth, to die for your sins, He had already decided that you are worthy of salvation. He had already decided that he desperately wants to save everyone. Everyone. Now, someone might say, but Dale, you just don't know. You don't know where I've been. You don't know what I've done. You can't be talking. You say, well, when I look at this church, you know, I'm not like everybody else. I mean, everybody else in this church, they're all saints, and I'm a sinner. You know, I hate to burst your bubble if you're thinking that, but this church is full of sinners. It's full of sinners. You know, maybe some of us have won a few more victories than you have, but everyone in this church needs Jesus every second of every day, just like you. Just like you do. Now, this promise is for everyone who's sick of their sin, everyone who's sick and tired of hurting those they love, everyone who's sick and tired of living an empty and meaningless life. And so if you're sick and tired of being sick and tired, if you're sick and tired of sin destroying your life, God says, I can take all of your sins away. Not just some of them, not just a few of them, not 10, not 100, not 1,000, but I can take them all away. Back in Psalm 103:12, God says, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. You know, when I was a boy, I had pink eye. But when I got better, what happened to that pink eye? It was gone. It was completely removed. If you look at me today, guess what? I don't have pink eye. You know what? When God looks at you today, if you're in Christ, if you're covered by the blood of Christ, if you've asked for salvation, what has he done with your sins? He has removed them. He's removed them how far?
Forever.
As far as the east is from the west. How far is that? A long, long ways. Amen? Now let me add something else that should be obvious here. When you ask for salvation, you should mean it. You don't want to be like the man who's drowning and he's desperately wanting help and he's crying out, and so people come and rescue him and he just walks away. And he says, never mind, I got this. You know, I've seen people do that at church. I've seen people come in and listen to a sermon and get all excited and come forward and get baptized. And then they walk out that door and they never look back. I've seen one time a couple come forward and I baptized both of them. And when they left this church, you know what they did? They went right back into their life of drugs. Haven't seen them since. I think really they didn't want to get rid of their sin. I think what they wanted to do was to get rid of their guilt. Let me tell you something this morning. It does no good to get rid of your guilt if you don't get rid of your sin. Because your sin will eventually bring that guilt right back. Amen? Amen. You know, when you call on God's name, what you're saying is, God, you are the only hope for my life. You are the only hope for my life. And you know, when you do that, you know what God says? He says, you're right. You're right. I am the only hope for your life. He says, stop looking for hope in a bottle of whiskey. Stop looking for hope in a bottle of pills. There is no hope there. It doesn't matter how many bottles you go through, you will never, ever find hope there. Notice the invitation that Jesus gives us in Matthew 11, 28. He says, come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And I will give you rest. Jesus is saying, call to me, come to me, and I will give you rest for your soul. That's the only place you can truly find rest for your soul. That's the only place you can truly find hope for your life is in Jesus. The second promise that you can take to the bank is the promise for strength. See, God knows that life is tough. He knows that we need his strength to make it from today to tomorrow to the next day. Notice Psalm 10, 17. David says, O Lord, you have heard the desire of the humble. In other words, people were praying. They were struggling. And he says, you have heard the desire of the humble. You will strengthen their heart. You will incline your ear. And I want you to notice those two words, you will. You will strengthen their heart. You will incline their ear. In other words, it's not a question mark. It's not that God might do it or he could do it. He says, you will. You will. Then over in Psalm 18, verses 31 through 32, David talks about how God had given him strength. He says, "For who is God but the Lord? And who is a rock except our God, the God who girds me with strength?" You know, when I think of that word gird, I just think of kind of God-given person like a Superman suit. Girds me with strength. He girds me with enormous power to live this life. Then he goes on in Psalm 18:38 and says, "For you have girded me with strength for battle. You have subdued under me those who rose up against me." And so when we pray for strength, when we seek God out and we ask for strength, he gives us strength to overcome the enemy. He gives us strength to overcome everything in our life. He gives us strength to win the battles in our life, whether the battle is finances, whether the battle is addiction, whether the battle is emotional, whether the battle has to do with your family. He will give you strength to overcome it. But here's the key. I don't want to say this, I'll say it again, but every one of God's promises are contingent on us believing God, on us trusting him. And one of the contingencies that we have to have if we're going to see God's blessing when it comes to strength is we have to realize that in and of ourselves that we are insufficient. We have to understand that we are insufficient. Let me share a valuable lesson that I've learned over the last 6.5 years of this ministry. And I came to this church 6.5 years ago with a clear vision of what it would take to turn this church around. The reason I have this clear vision is I've been in churches that were dying, and I've been in churches that were successful. I've read a lot of books, I've talked to a lot of pastors, and so God gave me a clear vision of what it would take. And so I started doing exactly what I believe would move us from a dying church into a church that would thrive someday. Let me say this as well, as I knew it would not be easy. I knew it wouldn't be easy because I've seen a lot of other people try it and fail. And what I need you to understand is what's taking place in this church is a miracle. This is not normal. Like I said, I knew it was going to be tough. But I believe that I could do what others could not or would not do. And that was a terrible mistake on my part. You know, all the things that have been done and that still need to be done are absolutely essential for us moving this church forward. But one thing I want to say, one thing that I've learned, especially in the last few months, that if God's not in it, it won't happen. If God's not in it, it won't happen in this church, and it won't happen in any other church. So when we think we can do it on our own, when we think we can do it in our own strength, we are greatly mistaken. Let me illustrate it this way. Have you ever tried to bake a cake, maybe left out a key ingredient? Say, maybe the eggs. Maybe you baked bread and forgot to put the yeast in it. That didn't turn out too well, did it? Now, everything in my vision, I believe, is a successful recipe for building a healthy and thriving church. But part of what I didn't know is for me to be around to fulfill this vision, to be here when this vision is completed, that my strength was not enough. But if I was going to finish this race, if I was going to finish this course, I needed God's strength. Now, last year, about 4 months ago, my strength ran out. 4 months ago, I was on the verge of quitting. Emotionally, my gas tank was on empty, and I knew I needed to do something, and I needed to do something quickly if I was going to stick around. And so I got on my knees and I prayed to God to help me. And he did. But God didn't just rush a bunch of strength into me or a bunch of energy or a bunch of hope. What he told me instead to do was to pray like I'd never prayed before. To read his word like I'd never read his word before. And he also told me to do something different. To take care of this temple that he's given me. Help me to understand that so much of our emotional energy is tied to how we are doing physically as well. But it all started when I was honest with God and said, my strength is not enough. It all started when I was honest with God and said, God, if you don't help me, I'm going to die. It all started when I said, God, if you don't help me, I'm helpless. See, that's a great prayer for anybody to pray. God, if you don't help me, I'm absolutely help us. The truth of the matter is we are never stronger than when we're on our knees. We are never stronger than when we're broken. Amen? I want to say this. I'm excited. I'm excited because the last 4 months have been incredible. Since I've been getting into God's Word, since I've been praying, since I've been taking care of this body. In fact, one of the things I did that I didn't think I'd ever be able to do is I quit drinking Diet Mountain Dew. Amen. Amen. And that's God's strength. That's God's strength to do it. And about the only way I can describe the last 4 months, which just have been great, is by reading from Isaiah 40, the last few verses. It says, He gives strength to the weary, and to him who lacks might, He increases power. Then he goes on to say, Yet those who wait for the Lord will gain new strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not get tired. They will walk and not become weary. And you know what? That's my life the last 4 months. And so I am a living testimony that if you pray to God for strength, and if you mean it, and if you do what He tells you to do, He gives it to you. Maybe there's someone here this morning. Maybe your emotional gas tank is on empty. Maybe you don't know if you can make it even another day. And I want to remind you of this. God is just a prayer away. But I'm betting that when you make that prayer, you ask God to help you, that He's probably going to tell you to do the same things that He told me to do. If you want strength, you've got to get in my Word. Let me tell you something we're doing right now. We have a read through the Bible program. That's a great time, a great way to make sure you're in the Word every single day. And so God may be asking you to get in His Word. If you want to find strength, you find it through His Word. He may tell you you need to get on your knees and you need to start praying like you've never prayed before. And show me that you're serious about this. And finally, He may be asking you to do some physical exercise. Now, I know not everybody can do that. I get that. But one of the neat things about doing physical exercise is God has built these little things into our bodies called endorphins. And when we exercise, we release these endorphins. And know what endorphins make you do? They make you feel good. And so when we exercise, they make us feel good. And that helps also to fill our emotional gas tank. And so God may be asking you to do that. Like I said, remember, God is only a prayer away. The third promise I want to talk about, the third promise that you can take to the bank, is the promise for wisdom. One of my memory verses that I'm working on right now is James 1:5. It says, If anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. And it will be given to him. In fact, one of the goals that I've set this year is to ask for wisdom at least 104 times. I'm going to ask for wisdom at least twice a week. In fact, I've made a new commitment kind of my own. I'm going to raise that up to 365 times this year. That I ask for wisdom every single day. And so if you want wisdom, what does James tell you to do? Ask for it. Ask for it. Now, as we talk about wisdom, let me ask this question. Who was the wisest man who ever lived other than Jesus? King Solomon. Does anybody know how King Solomon got his wisdom? He asked for it. He asked for it. In fact, in 2 Chronicles 1:10, Solomon says, Give me now wisdom and knowledge that I may go out and come in before this people. For who can rule this great people of yours? And the Bible goes on to tell us that because Solomon asked for wisdom and understanding over wealth, riches, and honor, that God not only gave him wisdom and understanding, but he also gave him wealth and riches and honor. In fact, if you read through the book of Proverbs, I'm telling you why. If you want wisdom, one of the best books you can read is the book of Proverbs. In fact, I made it my goal that I'm going to read through Proverbs every single month. So my goal is to read Proverbs 12 times this year. And one of the things that Proverbs tells you that when a person gets wise, the natural consequences are riches, wealth, and honor. That's the natural byproduct of being a wise person making wise decisions. Let me tell you this as well. In Solomon's day, there was nobody, no man, who was more famous than Solomon. People came from far and wide to listen to Solomon's wisdom. In fact, the Queen of Sheba is a great example of this. In 1 Kings 10, verses 6 through 7, she says, "It was a true report which I heard in my own land about your words and your wisdom. Nevertheless, I did not believe the reports until I came and my eyes had seen it. And behold, the half was not told to me. You exceed wisdom and prosperity the report which I heard." That's amazing, isn't it? That God gave him that kind of wisdom. You know what? God promises, he delivers. Now, other people may not believe it. They may think you're crazy if you believe it. But if you are a Christian, you have to believe it. That's called faith. And all of God's promises are contingent or conditional on our believing God. Back in Matthew 8:13, Jesus said, "It shall be done for you as you have believed." Done how? As you have believed. You know, if you read through the Gospels and you follow Jesus around, one of the things that you notice is that he does miracles everywhere. He does healings everywhere. Sometimes he even raises people from the dead. Like I said, he does miracles everywhere. He does healings everywhere except one place. Except one town. Can anybody tell me what the name of that town is? Nazareth. His hometown. His hometown. You know why he couldn't do miracles in his hometown? In fact, it tells us he did no miracles. He did just a few healings. You know why? Because of a lack of faith. Jesus said a prophet is without honor only in his hometown. And maybe you're struggling this morning believing God's promises. You need to pray. You need to pray for that as well. That God would help you with your struggles. That God would increase your faith. In fact, we see a great story of that right after Jesus came down from the Mount of Transfiguration with Peter, James, and John. His disciples, the other nine, had been left behind, and a father had brought his son to them, and they were unable to cast this demon out this boy had, this demon that kept trying to kill this boy. This boy was deaf and mute. And so the father, when Jesus comes down, the father comes up to Jesus, and he starts pleading and begging Jesus to help. And then he makes this statement. He says, "If you can do anything..." I mean, can you imagine the desperation? Can you imagine if you were that father? And Jesus says, "If you can do anything..." He says, "All things are possible to him who believes." All things are possible. And then Jesus asks him the most important question. He says, "Do you believe?" And the man says, "I believe, but help me with my unbelief." There's a part of me that really believes you, Jesus, yet there's this other part that just doesn't want to believe. And you can kind of understand why. His son had been like this his whole life. Nobody could help him. Not even Jesus' own disciples could help him. And yet Jesus told him to do what? To believe. To believe. Now, as we talk about wisdom, I want you to notice that it all began with Solomon asking God for wisdom. We've talked about that already. We've talked about the fact that James 1:5 makes the same statement. But I want to show you the connection between faith and God's promises. Because in verse 5, he says, "If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him." And then in verse 6, he says, "But he must ask in faith without any doubting, for the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the winds. For that man ought not to expect that he will receive anything from the Lord, being an unstable man, being a double-minded man, unstable in all of his ways." So can you see how important faith is to receiving God's blessings? See, we get saved by faith, we get strengthened by faith, and we get wisdom by faith. Let me close simply by saying this. God keeps his promises as we keep